we're going to have Airbus.
We still use it there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Her pre-PhD peer-reviewed papers cover the determination of the rotational periods of Neptune and Uranus, for the rotational temperature of Jupiter, masses of safer galaxies, and the total neutron cross-section of uranium. Her dissertation explains the now accepted idea behind the appearance of the whirlpool galaxy M51. Before coming to the U.S. Naval Observatory in October 2000, she spent 3 years at the National Science Foundation as a program manager for extragalactic astronomy and cosmology, and also executive secretary for the International Gemini Telescopes Project. At USNO, she was chief of the
felt free to add anything they liked to a publication. So this may have been altered. We're not sure this is exactly what it looked like. He was born in Baltimore County, Maryland, died in Baltimore County, Maryland, lived his entire life on his 100-acre family farm in near Ellicott City, what is now known as Ellicott City. He was a free black. And in 1830, which is after he died, Maryland had 52,000 free blacks, which is the highest any state had at the time. So Maryland was unique. If you go two states west of Ohio, they had one. So he lived up the farm, he worked the farm all his life. It was a tobacco farm. We think, and much of what is known about him is legendary. And the reason is that very little historical information has been recorded about Benjamin Banneker. What you see on the web, if you do a web search, is a lot of stuff copied from a few standard stuff that is not historically accurate. We think he was taught to read and write by his grandmother, Molly, and he may have attended 2 or 3 years of a Quaker school in near Ellicott City. But ever since then, he was self-taught. He inhaled books. He would borrow books from his neighbors in mathematics, in astronomy. What's next? Inventor, am I in the way? Inventor and surveying. And he would teach, just memorize them from page to page, and would teach himself mathematics, all these fields. So, mathematics. He loved to create and solve mathematical puzzles. And this is what I have for you who already know about him. This is one of his puzzles. Take the number 60 and divide it into four such parts, such that part 1 plus 4, part 2 minus 4, part 3 times 4, part 4 divided by 4, all equal the same number. Go. Mathematicians out there, solve. If you already know about him, this is to keep you busy during the rest of the talk. I do know the answer, so we can check each other. In astronomy, he learned the computations of orbits, which is actually rather technically difficult. He predicted a solar eclipse a year in advance, which meant he had to do orbit theory, so he knew enough astronomy to do that. He observed the eclipses of the Galilean moons, and I'll talk more about that later. He published several almanacs, and I'll talk more about that later too. But he just loved, he spent his nights on his farm under the pear trees looking at the stars. love to look at stars all night, and then he would study all day. He built a clock. Now, that doesn't sound like much today, but back in 1750, 1760, not many people had clocks in the colonies. So this clock was entirely out of wood. That's not a picture of it, because his clock burned down at his death. This is only what we think it looked like. Mythology says he built the first clock in the colonies. That's mythology. Other people have built clocks. He wasn't the first. But nonetheless, it was a very creative act, and it struck the hour, every hour of his life, until his death. And people would come from the neighborhood to watch the clock, because clocks were rare. We all know and love the 17-year locust cicadas, our local friends. He was one of the first people to recognize the 17-year cycle of the cicada. So that's pretty good. He was a naturalist. Farmer, like many farmers, he was a naturalist. Now, he proposed with Dr. Benjamin Rush, and he wrote to the government saying, I want you to establish a Department of Peace equal to the Department of War. And of course, that document still exists in the archives, but it wasn't until 1984 that the U.S. Institute of Peace was established. Nonetheless, he was one of the first to come up with the idea. Financially, I should go over here. Much better. Financially, he lived on this farm, this 100-acre farm, and as he aged, he grew too old to work the farm and take care of the tenants. He asked his neighbor, the Ellicott brothers, Ellicott City, to buy the land and pay him every year a certain amount of money. And in so doing, he calculated an actuarial table saying, I expect to live this many more years, and therefore each year I want you to give me so many pounds. It was 12 pounds. And in essence, this was kind of like the first reverse mortgage. Now, whether it was the first reverse mortgage, he got to live on the land during his lifetime and continue to get the profits from the land, but it was sold to the Ellicott brothers. Now, why this is good for Washington, he was on the survey team that surveyed the boundaries of the federal district that is now known as Washington, D.C. And that's why he's good for the Washington Academy of Sciences. The official history of Washington has the quote up there that a survey team led by Major Andrew Ellicott and his assistants, and astronomer Benjamin Banneker. That is one of the few historical points that we can say he was real. It actually is encoded, so we know he did this. When you survey, you put down boundary markers, or you did then. Every mile would be a boundary marker. And so they put down, if it was a 10 miles on a side rectangle, the original federal district, and they put boundary markers down, and some of the boundary markers still exist. That's a picture of one of them on Maple Street. They don't all exist anymore, but some of them do. So you can go find this one. They were laid down in 1791 and 1792 by the Ellicott brothers and their assistants. Flogging through Washington, what was the awful, swampy ground that Washington, D.C. was, dragging along surveyors. through the brambles, they would lay these boundary markers. This mural painting of him and Major Andrew Ellicott is in the Maryland House. If you go north of 95, north of Baltimore, and you go past Aberdeen, there's the Maryland House. It's on the wall. And this shows Benjamin Banneker and Major Ellicott surveying. And behind them is Ellicott's map of the city of D.C. So I recommend that you will see it, because it's not that hard to find. He was almost 60 when they asked him to join the survey team. The little thing on the right is going to show you how Washington, D.C. evolved. It started out like that, 10 miles on a side. And in the 1840s, the federal district gave the land back to Virginia and became what we now know as Washington, D.C. So there are some of those boundary markers in Alexandria. Is it changing? Most of you know that L'Enfant was asked to design the city. He was a well-known city designer of the time, L'Enfant Plaza. So this is the map. This is what he drew up as the design of the city. Now, George Washington, when he said, "I want a federal district," hired three commissioners to run the project. L'Enfant didn't think he worked for those guys. And there was a lot of friction. And he refused to turn over his plans of the city to the commissioners, or George Washington, or the archives. And so George fired him. And he was fired from the project, and it wasn't until 50 or 60 years later that they came back and reinterred him in Arlington National Cemetery and put down the mall, which was his original design, as the mall that we know today. A year later, Andrew Ellicott drew a design of the city, and that's what they worked from when they built the original city. That's the map that's behind the mural painting near Aberdeen. Recognize anything? I hope. I want you to notice something on this map. Oops. Longitude is zero at the capital. He has the latitude correct, and he says the longitude is zero at the capital. That's important to remember. Now we're going to survey. That doesn't mean I'm going to ask you who you voted for. That means I'm going to try to figure out what the latitude and longitude is up for the boundaries of the federal district. That's what they were after, determining latitude and longitude. And at this point, we get boring, because I'm going to tell you all about latitude and longitude, more than you ever wanted to know. We'll start out simple. We live on a great big ball. You're there, and your horizon is unique to you. Okay, everybody got that? We live on a great big ball. It takes two coordinates to define where you are on a globe. A left-right one and an up-down one, and we all know the up-down one is latitude and the left-right one is longitude. We weren't the first to think of this. It came up in the 2300 years ago with Eratosthenes, ancient Greek, who put latitude and longitude on his map of the world. And the scale it, that's the Mediterranean Sea. That is what they thought the world consisted of to the ancient Greeks. So that they also thought of latitude and longitude. Latitude, we can figure out. By the second century, 2,200 years ago, everybody could do latitude. All it took, I didn't bring my ruler in, but was a sight along the horizon, go up to the North Star, Polaris, and follow the plumb line down. And that angle, 90 degrees minus that angle, is your latitude. We use a sextant today to do this. Sextants evolved over time, and in the upper left corner is an old-fashioned quadrant that they used to do this. But modern-day sextants are on the left. And you don't have to use the North Star Polaris. You can use the sun if you're careful. And modern-day sextants have devices to block out the sun light. Now, you're not asking, but I'm going to tell you anyway. This was for the northern hemisphere. Let us suppose you're in the southern hemisphere. You can't see Polaris. What do you do? There is no southern star like Polaris. In the southern hemisphere, the Southern Cross points to the south celestial pole, which is a blank dot in the sky. And you find it, if you're clever, same rule, once you find it, it's 90 degrees minus your angle. You actually go with Centaurus and bisect Centaurus, and the two lines intersect at the south celestial pole. So it takes a few more steps if you're in the southern hemisphere, a little more math. But you still can do it. It still finds your altitude. 90 degrees minus your altitude gives you your latitude. Longitude, however, well, Hipparchus said, if you happen to have a lunar eclipse around, you can do simultaneous measurements of the lunar eclipse over here and here, and use that to determine your longitude. That means time is important for longitude. Angles are important for latitude. Time is important for longitude. Very important. By the way, Benjamin Franklin used this tidbit. I heard some people talking about weather. When there was a lunar eclipse, and the people in D.C. observed the wind speeds in D.C., and the people in Boston at the same time did the wind speeds in Boston, and he was the one that put on the weather map the fact that the surface wind speeds do not have to match the forward motion of the storm. And that was one of the early weather studies, something Franklin did. But if you want to do in the 1800s, 1700s, you just can't depend upon there being a lunar eclipse. They don't occur that often. Someone must define somewhere on the globe where you start. Do you all know where we start now? Greenwich. Right. Do you know why? We're going to choose Greenwich. Ellicott chose D.C. Remember, he had longitude equals zero for D.C., capital. But do you know why Greenwich was chosen? It was decided by international treaty in 1884, and it was hotly debated because Paris did it in Paris. The Paris Observatory, if you go there, still has the prime meridian line going down the Paris Observatory. They wanted it in Paris, England wanted it in England, the DC people wanted it. Jefferson had the trade and had the money, it ended up in Greenwich. And there's a picture of it. If you've ever been to Greenwich, that's what it looks like. The prime meridian. 0 degrees longitude. But time is important. So if you have a clock that ticks at the time at 0 degrees longitude, you're going to need that. That is called, in the 1700s, they called that an astronomical clock. We don't call it that today, but that's what it was called in the 1700s. Now, the clock, you can't let it stop. Because if it stops, how are you going to call home in 1770 when you're on a different continent? And the only way you can get back to Greenwich is to sail many months. So you can't let it stop. You just can't get home again. Now, Banneker was assigned the task of winding the clock. That was one of his surveying tasks, was to keep that clock wound. So it was very, very important, because if the clock ever stopped, they were dead in the water. They used DC eventually, but they started at Greenwich. What do you do if you're not at Greenwich? Now, these people were not at Greenwich. You need a time listing, time-ordered list of positions of the sun, moon, planets, and stars at a future time, because you're going to be gone in the future, and Greenwich is going to be over here ticking away at Greenwich time. You're going to be here later, so you need a clock where you are at your local time, and you need your Greenwich time. You need two clocks. You compare the two clocks, and that's how you get longitude. It sounds simple. Just for definitions, if you've never heard of an ephemeris is a time-ordered list, that's all it is, of future positions of celestial objects. The plural of ephemeris is ephemerides. You know, why is longitude important? They missed the Mediterranean by 1,100 miles. It was off by 19 degrees. And when Columbus sailed, he carried with him an ephemeris by a German astronomer, and it predicted eclipses, and he crashed on the island of Jamaica and wowed the natives of Jamaica with the upcoming eclipse. And he knew about it because he had an ephemeris. All captains and navigators had ephemerides with them. They didn't dare sail without them, because that was their key. An almanac is just an ephemeris plus the rest. An ephemeris plus eclipses, plus holidays, plus poems, plus pictures, plus whatever you want to put in there. And in those days, 1700s, they did put poems and pictures and other things, family stories and letters and things in there. This is what a modern ephemeris would look like on a computer. This is part of it. The time ordered listing goes in Greenwich time from in hours down here. The first point of Aries for Venus, for a couple of planets and some bright stars, and it goes on further on. But you can, that's what a modern ephemeris would look like. Okay, math time. We all know the Earth rotates once a day, I hope. 360 degrees in a day. We're overlooking the little bit that was left over right now for this purpose. 360 degrees in 24 hours, 180 degrees in 12 hours, 90 degrees in 6 hours, 45 degrees in 3 hours. We're going to get down to what's important here at the bottom. 15 degrees in 1 hour. That means the Earth is turning 15 degrees in 1 hour. So if you're living at the equator, you're traveling 1,675 kilometers an hour. So as you sit here, you are not at the equator, but you are traveling almost that fast. You just think you're sitting there. 1/60th of a degree is an arc minute. 1/60th of an hour is 1 minute. So 15 arc seconds in 1 minute of time. And 1/60th again, 15 arc seconds in 1 second of time. That's those 15 degrees in an hour and 15 arc seconds are the important ones. So if it is 18 hours and some change here in Greenwich, and it is what time? 9:20 where you are, it is 8 hours and 40 degrees difference. So longitude, you turn it into degrees. That's all you're doing. 8 times 15 degrees per hour. We turn the 40 minutes into hours by dividing by 60. And so you end up with your longitude. 2 clocks, that's all it takes, if you've got the 2 clocks set correctly. So let's say you want to choose Jupiter to look at as your celestial object locally. You've got your ephemeris with the Greenwich mean time for Jupiter, time ordered list. You need a sextant for your latitude. You need a telescope to look for Jupiter. You find Jupiter. You need a clock at your local time that tells you when you are looking at Jupiter. Compare the clocks and you've got your longitude and your latitude. So you could do this with almost anything in the sky if you had an ephemeris, a proper ephemeris. Clocks were not too good in those days. Sundials are only good to about 20 minutes a day. A pendulum clock may be a good to a minute or two, down to 10 seconds. But the key is 10 seconds error is the maximum a ship can take at sea in the 1700s on its clock that it carries aboard its ship. So it can't be a pendulum because that swings. Can't have a pendulum aboard a ship. Why does the 10 seconds matter? In other words, how much error are you putting in the system? At sea level, we define 1 nautical mile. That's how it's defined. At sea level, along 1 arc minute is defined to be 1 nautical mile, or that many kilometers and that many miles. That's the definition. 1 arc second is 1/60th of that, or about 30 meters. 15 arc seconds is 1 second of time. 10 seconds error is 150 arc seconds error. That means you are off by 4.5 kilometers. If you have a 10 second error in your clock, that's why a ship can handle about that much swing in heading for port. And that's why it needed a port person from the port to run in. They could get that close. Galileo, to back up, discovered the 4 moons of Mars. Got 2 moons of Mars. He discovered the Galilean moons, the 4 brightest moons of Mars. Astronomers soon realized this could be a clock. If you have a proper listing of when they're going to be, where they're going to be. Galileo's list was not too good. His telescope wasn't good enough. Later, Cassini gave a pretty good list of where they were going to be by timing the eclipse of the moon going behind Jupiter, just as it goes behind this side, and comes out on this side and gives you those times. And voila, you have a clock. You can use that as a celestial clock, and it was used to calculate the longitude of the Mason-Dixon line. They used this technique. That was one of your clocks. Today, it looks like this. The one on the left is a printed page, and they put the satellites down in waving lines, and Jupiter goes down the middle. And on the other side, the right side, is your cell phone. You've got an app for this. You can get an app, I mean, there are lots of apps, for finding out where the Galilean satellites are at any given time, if you ever cared to know. Benjamin did observations of the Galilean satellites for the survey team. That meant he gave them part of the clock. So he kept the Greenwich Mean Time clock wound, and he kept the local clock keyed to the Galilean satellite eclipse times.
Here's Io. Here's Io. Perhaps Callisto is easier. Callisto there. Callisto there.
They were very easy to watch as they came and went. They had their speeds were such that you had a good chance at actually timing the eclipses. He made several almanacs. He created all the computations necessary for the ephemeris, for the sun, moon, planets, and stars. He calculated the eclipses. He put in the poems. He put in the letters. And they were published in
four states? Is it
four states and six cities? And he found a printer for them. And they were best sellers in their time. And today, as far as I know, there are extant only two copies of that ephemeris left. One is held by the Maryland Historical Society, and the other is held by either Georgetown or George Mason. I forget which university has it, and they won't give it up. So there are only two copies I know of. I don't even know if the Library of Congress has a copy. That's a faceplate of his 1792 ephemeris, but on the other side is Benjamin Franklin's For Richard's Almanac. He did the same thing. Franklin also did an almanac. They contained the same things, the rising and setting times of the sun, moon, and stars, and eclipses, and Franklin stuck in all his cheap little sayings, and Banneker stuck in poems. He was honored with a stamp, which is nice. Not everybody gets honored with a stamp. The Benjamin Banneker Museum exists in Catonsville, Maryland, on his family property. Well, it used to be his family property. And I recommend that you go visit it. It tells about his life story, but it does not tell you about his science accomplishments. And they are working very hard on adding to their collection by putting in the science on latitude and longitude and clocks and almanacs and everything else that matters scientifically. It's in Catonsville. Little tiny road to get there, and all of a sudden you're on a big, big park. The log cabin is a recreation, because at his death, his log cabin in which he lived burned down, and we lost all of his records. That's why there's very little historical information about it. The Federal Gazette wrote the following: Mr. Banneker is a prominent instance to prove that a descendant of Africa is susceptible of as great mental improvement and deep knowledge into the mysteries of nature
questions.
No, he never married. He had nieces and nephews. He had a large family, but he never married. So his land went to the Elder Brothers. Yeah.
This is a statement, not a question. I understand that when the American Society of Civil Engineers surveyed the remaining boundary markers, a couple of them had for same as boundary markers.
That's wonderful. I didn't know that. That's terrific. Another question? Any others?
All right, let's give her another hand. That's how that's going to run. Thanks.